Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Last week in the class of the tafseer of the Qur'an through the Seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we're looking at the cause of the opposition of some of the mushrikeen to the da'wah, the call of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this week inshallah ta'ala, we're going to be looking at the seventh set of verses to be set upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Surah At-Takwir. This was the seventh set of verses to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after Ad-Da'wah Al-Jahriya, after the open propagation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These set of verses deals with the opposition which you mentioned of the mushrikeen to the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what they had the opposition to was a fundamental pillar of faith. A fundamental pillar of faith which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many ayat, He mentions it along with what? Believing on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَالَّذِينَ هَادُوا وَالنَّصَارَ وَالصَّابِئِينَ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala along with what? Belief in the last day and everything that involves the last day, such as the day of judgment and resurrection. So this surah, it deals with this. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يَنْظُرَ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَإِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ كَأَنَّهَا رَأْيَ الْعَيْنِ فَلْيَقْرَأْ إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ. Whoever loves or wants to see what يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ would truly be like, as though he could see it with his own eyes, should read the surah إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ. So the name of this surah, as it was named by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ. This is the name which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave it. Even though majority of the masahif we have today is named Surah At-Takwir. It's named Surah At-Takwir according to the meaning of the surah, which is Takwir, that the sun will be folded up or wrapped up. But another name for it is according to one of the utterances or the exact wording in the ayah, which is what? Either Shamsu Kubwirat. Just like Surah Al-Infitar. One of the names of Surah Al-Infitar is what? Either Sama'un Fatarat. That is named after one of its verses or named after its meaning, Al-Infitar. So one of the names of the surah, Either Shamsu Kubwirat. So we're looking at Surah At-Takwir or Surah Either Shamsu Kubwirat. This surah, Ya Salman, is it Makkiyah or Madaniyah? Alhamdulillah. Is your father here? Alhamdulillah. If you got that wrong, you'll be very upset. Because we're in the beginning of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's Makkiyah, barakallahu feek. Not only is it Makkiyah, it's from the early surah that came down in Makkah. The seventh surah to come down in Makkah. And this surah, for those who've done their homework, because I always say before the class, you should prepare for the class. Ya Qaisar, how many ayah or ayat in this surah? No one did their homework before the class. Before every single class, do your own research before the class. Prepare yourself for the class. Naam, ya Shaykhana. Naam. This surah has 29 ayat, 29 verses. And like we said, this surah deals with what? The opposition to the mushrikeen concerning the day of judgment. Now, out of these 29 ayat, these 29 verses, the first 15 verses deals with what? Or 16 verses deals with what? The issue of Yawm al-Qiyamah. And the verses that come after that from verse 16 or verse 15, it deals with the other opposition of the mushrikeen that we mentioned last week to the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what was the other oppositions they had to the da'wah? What were the other oppositions? Other than the last day, what did we mention last week? Barakallahu feek. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the truthfulness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a human being. How could a human being be a messenger? What was another opposition, Ya Qaisar? Okay, as a human being, they couldn't accept it. Human messenger. So what did they expect to descend with him? Barakallahu feek. They expected angels to descend with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also, the other opposition was to what? The Qur'an, the truthfulness of the Qur'an. So the second half of the surah, it deals with this. With three qasam, three oaths or three verses which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears to prove the truthfulness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the truthfulness of Jibreel, and also the truthfulness of what? The Qur'an, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the second half of the surah, it begins with the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِالْخُنَّسِ الْجَوَارِ الْكُنَّسِ. This is an oath by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah ta'ala says, I swear by the retreating stars, الْجَوَارِ الْكُنَّسِ. Those stars that they appear and all of a sudden, they disperse and they disappear. So this is an oath from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how many oaths? One. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا عَسْعَسْ. Allah ta'ala says, I swear by the night as it draws close. وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا تَنَفَّسْ. And I swear by the morning as it breathes. So how many qasam? Three qasam. And these three qasam for what? To prove the truthfulness of the Prophet ﷺ, Jibreel and the Qur'an. So what ayah comes after that? وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا عَسْعَسْ وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا تَنَفَّسْ إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلُ رَسُولٍ كَرِيمٍ. This is a word of an honorable messenger. And who is this messenger? Jibreel alayhi salam. Because the next ayah, ذو قوة عند ذي العرش المكين. The one that has power and might and is positioned at the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, makin, with authority and security. So this is Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam. ذو قوة عند ذي العرش المكين مطاع ثم أمين. And this angel is not like any other angels, but rather Jibreel Muta'in is an angel that in the heaven he is obeyed and is a trustworthy angel. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after Muta'in thumma ameen, what does Allah ta'ala say after that? Barakallahu fi. So we have two ayah dealing with Jibreel to show the greatness of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That which the mushrikeen wanted, that the angel descends with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, forget an angel descending with him, the best of angels descended. And that's why in Surah Al-Qadr, Allah ta'ala says, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. Not تَنزِلُ, not the angels descend, Allah to qadr, تَنَزَّلُ يَدُلُّ عَلَى إِسْتِمْرَاءِ. The angels continue to descend, that the numbers of angels on the face of the earth are more than pebbles on the face of the earth. But after all these angels that have descended, innumerable angels, Allah Ta'ala says, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَ وَالْرُوحِ. And what also descends? Ar-Ruh, Jibreel alayhi salam. That this, to show the heaviness of this message, you didn't just choose any messenger, but Jibreel alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about these three things concerning the truthfulness of Jibreel. And then Allah Ta'ala says, وَمَا صَحِبُكُمْ بِمَجْنُونَ. And your companion is not a madman. And who is this? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا هُوَ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ بِضَنِينَ. And he, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, concerning the unseen, he doesn't withhold or have knowledge of the unseen. وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ. Is it ayah? بِالْأُفُقِ الْمُبِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and he, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw him, saw who? In the clear horizon. Jibreel alayhi salam. And we mentioned this in the beginning of the seerah. So question to you, this ayah, وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ بِالْأُفُقِ الْمُبِينِ. Is this the first time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Jibreel, or the second time in his true form? In his first, the first time. Barakallahu feek. And what is the dalil from the seerah? Barakallahu fi. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was walking and he saw in the horizon Jibreel alayhi salatu was salam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed what? Ya ayyuha al-muddathir. Barakallahu fi. So Allah ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ بِالْأُفُقِ الْمُبِينِ. And the ayah read before that came after this. وَمَا هُوَ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ رِضَانِينَ. And Muhammad is not withholder of the knowledge of the unseen. So this is now defense of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What about the defense of the Qur'an? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says after that, وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ شَيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. This is not the word of shaitan. That this is not the word of the devil. فَأَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ. Where are you going to go? So the last part of the surah deals with what? Defense of these three things. And the beginning deals with what? Issue of يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. So in the beginning, we have 12 qasam, 12 oath that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he makes to show the seriousness of having iman in Yawm al-Qiyamah. These 12 oaths in the beginning of the surah, as Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he mentioned that sitta minha tata'allaq bi ad-dunya. Six of them is connected to the dunya. And the other six is connected to akhirah, the hereafter. But this is talking about yawm al-qiyamah. So how could it be connected to dunya and akhirah? The way it is connected is the first six tata'allaq bi akhir ad-dunya. The first six is connected to the end of this dunya, the end of this world. Jayyid, which is yawm al-qiyamah. And the other six is connected to what? Bidayatul akhirah. So they join one to the other. The other six is connected to what? The beginning of the life of the hereafter. So the first six is connected to what? The dunya, the end of the dunya. And the six after that is connected to what? The beginning of akhirah. So one is connected to yawm al-qiyamah, and the other is connected to what? Al-ba'ath, resurrection. Qiyamah and ba'ath. Jayyid? Now all these 12 verses, although six is connected to one thing, the other six is connected to something else, they have one thing in common. Ya Habib, for those who have done their homework. One of the things you mentioned one day, I think the brother's not here today, he asked me about al-jinas, which is the rhyming or the rhythmic or patterns we get in the book of Allah Ta'ala with certain surah. For example, Surah Al-Qamar. Every ayah ends with a what? Ra. اقتربت الساعة وانشق القمر. What's the next ayah? وإن يروا آية وإن يروا آية يا لقمان سحر مستمر بعده وكذب وتبع أهواءهم. In this surah, likewise, the first 12 verses, there's something, for those who did the homework, that's repeated in the first 12 verses. And what is that? We know Surah Al-Takwir, Ya Salman. You know Surah Al-Takwir? Tayyib, read. Idha shamsu. Barakallahu fi. إذا الشمس كورت وإذا النجوم كدرت وإذا الجبال سيرت. What do you notice in every single ayah? إذا 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 إذا. Every single ayah from the Torah begins with what? إذا. What does إذا mean? إذا is a letter in Arabic that is used أداة الشرط للمستقبل. It's used for conditional. We're not going to get too grammatical here, but it's used for conditional sentences concerning the future. So either you use it to set a condition. And every single condition has a what? A consequence. That if the condition is such, the consequence is going to be such. So whenever you hear either, automatically, what do you wait for? The consequence. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says either. The next thing you automatically wait for is a what? The consequence. Now in normal speech, it suffices just to say either once. If this happened, and then this, and then this, and then this, it suffices. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for every single verse use either. Like every single khabar is mustaqil. Every single incident is by itself. Because of what? The severity of every single incident. So this either, for those taking notes, either in the Qur'an or in the Arabic language is used for two purposes. First, a tashweeq, to cause you to yearn, to be curious and want to find out what's going to happen. Because when they say either, when this happens, what are you waiting for? The consequence. So either is used the tashweeq al-khabar ladhi ba'da, to find out what's going to happen next. Secondly, especially in this context, either is used for what? A takhweef, to make you scared. That when this happens, because the phenomena or the scenarios been described in this surah, they're not normal. That either it makes you have what? Takhweef. So two things. At-tashweeq, yearning for the news, and what? At-takhweef. So every single one of these single ayah, the 12 ayat connected to dunya wal akhirah, They begin with what? Idha. With Idha. So in the beginning of the surah, as I mentioned, Surah Makkiyah is a Meccan surah, the early Meccan surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins with adatu shart, this conditional sentence that has a consequence. That idha shamsu, that when the sun, what happens to the sun? When the sun is wrapped or becomes wrapped up. This is one of the tafseer of the ayah. Idha shamsu kubirat. That when the sun, it becomes wrapped up. Now, another tafsir is when the sun becomes dark, when it loses its light. But in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions a noun and a verb. And I'm not getting grammatical on you because I'm an English language teacher. I'm becoming grammatical because part of understanding the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to understand the Arabic language and the sciences of the Arabic language. Before learning Arabic, I had no interest in grammar. If you'd asked me before Arabic, what is a noun? No idea. Adverb? No idea. Adjective? No idea. You know, conditional sentence? No idea. But learning Arabic, it made me realize these sciences. That when you learn Arabic and Arabic grammar, English grammar is nothing. It's a walk in the park. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, he mentioned a noun and a verb. Where is the noun, ya Luqman? Either shams or kubirat. Where's the noun in when the sun is wrapped up? Where's the noun? Barakallahu fik, ashams. And the verb is what? Wrapped up. In this ayah, the noun is mentioned before the verb. Normal Arabic speech would be either kawarat ashams. Would be to mention the verb before the noun. That when the wrapping, and this is the verb now, of the sun takes place, or the folding of the sun takes place, the noun or the verb will normally come before the what? The noun, in normal Arabic speech. But the difference in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that the noun came first. Why? The noun came first because the noun which Allah ta'ala is speaking about, which is the sun, is something that's firmly etched and we could imagine, and the image is set in our minds. It's set in our minds. We know what the sun is like. So any difference, any alteration in the sun automatically does what to the brain? It shocks the brain. The other day we had a lunar eclipse. Before that, there's been solar eclipses, which I've witnessed. And when people see the solar eclipse, they become scared, like it's Yawm al-Qiyamah. They think it's the day of judgment already. So Allah Ta'ala mentions the sun first because it's planted in your mind, the image of the sun. Then Allah Ta'ala said, kuwirat. When the sun becomes dark, it has more of an effect. That this sun, which you could imagine, you could picture, kuwirat, that will become dark, the sun will be folded up. And folded up is one of the interpretation, and also one of the interpretation is that the sun will be thrown, it will be wrapped up and folded, it will be thrown. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, "Ash-shamsu wal-qamar mukawwiran yawm al-qiyamah." That the sun and the moon yawm al-qiyamah will be folded, wrapped up, and they'll be thrown. In another narration, they'll be thrown into the hellfire. So one interpretation is when the sun becomes dark, when the sun becomes wrapped up. And also another interpretation is what? When the sun, tataharrak, the sun just starts moving. It doesn't move. And this is one of the things we see in the solar or lunar eclipse. That the sun and the moon, they usually have different times of orbiting. But this ayah, either shamsu kuwirat, means when the sun it stops its normal movement of rising in the where? East and set in the west, it just stops. And this is the meaning of the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that yawm al-qiyamah, that idha jumi'ati ash-shamsu wal-qamar. That which you see from lunar eclipse is nothing. Idha jumi'ati ash-shamsu wal-qamar. That yawm al-qiyamah, the sun and the moon jumi'at, they'll come together. If you imagine that scenery, you see the sun and the moon jumi'at, because it's not moving. And it'd be so shocking, طبعاً يقول الإنسان يومئذٍ أين المفر. That mankind on that day will say, where is the escape? كلا لا وزر. On that day, there's no refuge. So when the meaning is الشمس كورت, they come to a complete stop. You see the sun, you see the moon. And this is something, subhanAllah, shocking to the mind. And after this now, after this tashweep, that you want to know what is going to happen is الشمس كورت. What is going to happen? After this takhweef, after this fear, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention? The consequence? La. The consequence is not mentioned. 12 ayat, either, no mention of the consequence on the 13th ayah. عَلِمَتْ نَفْسٌ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ. Every soul will know then what is brought forward. So in the next ayah, rather than mention the consequence, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? وَإِذَنْ نُجُومٌ كَدَرَتْ وَإِنْكِدَارْ النُّجُومُ. And when the sun, or so when the stars, in كَدَرَتْ, meaning, they say when they lose their light. One of the tafseer is when they lose their light. Another tafseer, إِذَنْ نُجُومٌ كَدَرَتْ, is the stars will become scattered. They just scatter in the sky. And this is tafsir al-Qur'an, the tafsir al-Qur'an with the what? With the Qur'an. Because there's an ayah in the Qur'an that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the star. One of the names of the star is what? Kawakib. Jayid. And this surah or this ayah is similar to this ayah. Is that ayah with Kawakib? After this surah. What's the ayah? What's the surah after this surah, Ya Salman? Ba'da takweer. Barakallahu feek. Infitar. What's the ayah, Muhammad? That Kawakib in Infitar. Huh? Wa idha al kawakibu. Huh? Tatharat. When the stars become scattered. There's no contradiction between this and that, that they become dark and scattered. Why? Because these events, they either happen in stages or happen at once. So it's either this will happen first or this will happen first. So when the tafsir of the ayah is that, وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ كَدَرَتْ, is that the stars, they'll become scattered. Now after that, you're waiting for what is going to happen. Then now even more shocking news. وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ سُيِّرَتْ. That the mountains, which is a sign of strength and might. That if somebody is strong, you call him a what? A mountain. If he has knowledge, metaphorically, he says he's a mountain of knowledge. That these great structures that we see, creation of Allah Azza wa Jalla, that's a sign of might. Allah Ta'ala said, وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ سُيِّرَتْ. They'll just be removed, suddenly disappear. يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. This mountain that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says about, that وَتَرَى الْجِبَالَ وَتَرَى الْجِبَالَ وَتَحْسَبُهَا جَامِدًا. That you see the mountains and you consider them as being what? As being rigid. But يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ تَمُرُّ مَرَّ السَّحَارِ. The mountains will move like clouds, subhanAllah. They move just like cows. So on this day, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ سُيِّرَتْ. They'll disappear. How they disappear? Allahu A'lam. In order the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَكُونُ الْجِبَالُ كَالْعِينَ. That the mountains on that day will become like wool. وَلَا يَسْأَلُ حَمِيمٌ حَمِيمًا. That no friend, when he sees this, is not going to ask about another friend. When you see the mountains become like what? Like wool. So this mountain, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ, will disappear completely. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَحُمِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ وَالْجِبَالِ. That the earth, with vastness, وَالْجِبَالِ, and the jibal does what to the earth? It keeps it down, it's a peg. That the jibal in Surah An-Naba, أَوْتَادَ. But both of them, وَحُمِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ وَالْجِبَالِ, both of them will be carried, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. فَدُكَّتَ دَكَّةً وَاحِدًا, and will be crushed with a single blow. Subhanallah. فَدُكَّتَ دَكَّةً وَاحِدًا فَيَوْمَئِذٍ وَقَعَتِ الْوَاقِعَةِ. On that day, that true event will take place, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. So, إِذَا الْجِبَالُ سُيِّرَتْ. So, after mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ سُيِّرَتْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا الْعِشَارُ عُطِّلَتْ. And when the ishar are abandoned. What is ishar? Ishar, I think in the translation is, and when the full term, she camels are neglected. A full term, al-ishar, al-naqa, fi al-naqa al-hamil, fi hamliha al-ashir, is a camel that is pregnant in its 10th month. Camels generally are from the most prized possession of forms of transportation of the Arabs in the past, and their most valuable wealth. They used to measure their wealth in what? In camels. And this is not just any camel. This is a she camel that's in the 10th month, very valuable. And not only in the past, even presently, now, the most prized possession of the Arabs is what? Camels. It's very valuable to them. I remember when I was working as a lecturer in King Saud University with Qaisar, we used to have a project called continuous assessment where the students had to give presentation. That presentation that year was for every single student in the university to come up with a business idea. You remember this? We had to get to come up with a business. Me and Luqman had a class next to each other. And we're actually in competition, by the way. I said, in my class, I have the Steve Jobs of Saudi Arabia. This guy could sell ice to Eskimos. He could sell sand to the Arabs. He had speech. Inna min al-bayan al-sihr. His speech was like magic. So we were supposed to compete the two classes. So one of the students in my class, he came up with an idea, some kind of an app. And this app, mashallah, tabarakallah, was so good. On its opening, he had the idea, but he implemented. Someone else took the idea. I think that app immediately made either riyal or American dollars, $80,000, immediately. So I'm going through the ideas of the students, correcting their work, because whatever idea they come up with, it was just for English anyway, even if it's a bad idea. But I wanted to make sure it's a good idea, that, you know, it's also implementable and practical. One of the students came up with an idea regarding the value of car. Initially, I laughed. But this student, this particular student, because I was teaching level C with him, level C is the highest levels you could teach in King Saud. This student came up with an idea, and I'm surprised he could come up with this idea. Because to me, initially, it sounded like a silly idea. And he's the cleverest student in my class, the brightest in my class. He came up with this idea. I said, what is your idea? He said, my idea is, for business proposal, is plastic surgery on camels. For subhanAllah. Plastic surgery. So, okay. I said, what kind of plastic surgery? I can't remember what this plastic surgery is called, where you insert fat into people's lips. You know, some people make their lips bigger. What's it called again? Lip filling. He said, my idea is, there's a word for it. The other one when you take it is liposuction. The other one is something else. Botox, yes, for camels. To make their lips bigger. I said, subhanAllah. I said, look, I don't think this is a good idea. All the students, when he mentioned it, they're like, subhanAllah, what a great idea. Why did we never think of this? And then I researched. And I found the most valuable camels, even I was watching the National Day here, is the one that their lips are big and is hanging like this. That if he got into the business, because the bigger the lips are, the more it's worth. This is how much they value these camels. They pay hundreds of thousands, even millions, for these camels with these lips like this. So if you watch the National Day on TV here, and you saw the camels that were in the front, they're the ones the lips are drawing like this, that he's going to start performing Botox for camels. This is how much they value these animals, subhanAllah. So Allah Ta'ala mentioned the she-camel. And not only is it a form of transport, it's also from the most prized of their wealth. That uttilat, these as prized as they are, meaning the Lamborghinis, the Corvette, mashaAllah Ta'ala, that we saw outside, or the Mercedes, or whatever they are, turiket, they'll be abandoned yawm al-qiyamah. Whatever you have in terms of wealth, real estate, money, everything, turiket, they'll be abandoned. And even these lovely children, which are in our sight, our own possession, most prized possession, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that day, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اِتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّ زَلْزَلَةَ سَاعَ شَيْءٌ عَظِيمٌ. O mankind, fear your Lord, verily the shaking of the hour is a great thing. يَوْمَ تَرَوْنَهَا. On that day when you see it, تَذْهَلُ كُلُّ مُرْضِعَةٍ عَمَّا أَرْضَعَتْ. Everything in every human who's breastfeeding and the child is suckling will drop that thing. And we know the closeness of a mother to a child when the child is suckling. Drop it. وَتَضَعَ كُلُّ ذُعَةِ حَمْلٍ حَمْلَهَا. Everyone who has a load pregnant to fail that day would drop that load immediately. Would drop the load, conceive immediately. So therefore, تُرِكَتْ وَعِذَا الْعِشَارُ عُطِّلَتْ. These things will be, they'll be abandoned, they'll be left. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ. Al-wuhush are the animals. When the wild beasts, they're gathered. Al-hushirat means gathered. And the delil of that saying of Allah Azza wa Jalla concerning Fir'aun, fahashara fanada. Fahashara, he gathered his people and he pronounced. So hashar means to gather. Jayyid. So the word hashar, it means to gather. Like the saying of Allah Azza wa Jalla, wahasharnahum. Or saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, uhshiru alladhina zalamu. Gather those who oppress. Wa azwajahum, and their wives to Jahannam. So when the beasts, they are gathered. Now, why is this an amazing scenery? Beasts, they don't gather. They don't unite together in one place. They will attack each other. But such is the terror of that place that they'll be driven to a spot by the terror and they'll just gather there without attacking each other. وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ In the ayah, in Infitar, is وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ فُجِّرَتْ But here, سُجِّرَتْ, when they're on flames. Like we said, there's no contradictions. Either these events could take place at once, be in flames and explode, or explode first, or be in flames first. So Infitar is very similar to At-Takwir. وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ So all of these ayah, how many have we reached now? Six. جيد. All these six ayah تتعلق بماذا؟ دنيا. آخر الدنيا, the end of the dunya. So from now on is what? بداية الآخر, the beginning of the hereafter. And the beginning of the hereafter is the saying of Allah Azza wa Jal, وَإِذَا النُّفُوسُ زُوِّجَتْ That when the souls, they appeared. What does it mean they appeared? Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu and the tafseer ibn Kathir is pairing of the righteous souls with the righteous souls and the evil souls with the evil souls. That Yawm al-Qiyamah, those who are righteous will be raised together and the evil people will be paired together. And those righteous souls, when they're paired and they're raised together, لا خوف عليه, they have no fear. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned the benefit of loving one another for the sake of Allah. That Yawm al-Qiyamah, there will be people, libasuhum nur, wujuhuhum nur, their clothing will be made of light, their face is made of light. يَغْبِتُهُمْ النَّبِيُّونَ وَالشُّهَدَى That even the prophets and the martyrs who are killed on the path of Allah, they'll be jealous of these people. The Sahaba, when they heard, they said, Ya Rasulullah, sifhum lana. O Messenger of Allah, tell us, who are these people? He said, هُمْ مُتَحَابُونَ فِي اللَّهِ They're people that love each other for the sake of Allah. وَمُتَجَالِسُونَ فِي اللَّهِ People that sit together, we pray Allah Ta'ala makes of those people that are sitting together now for the sake of Allah, for a dars. There'll be no fear upon the Yawm al-Qiyamah. Likewise, people that are muttaqoon, Allah Ta'ala said, Al-akhillahu yawma idhin ba'duhum li ba'din adu. The closest of people, the most beloved of people, Yawm al-Qiyamah, they'll be enemy one to the other, illa al-muttaqoon, except for those who fear Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So, وَإِذَا النُّفُوسُ زُوِّجَتْ meaning the pairing, Al-akhiyar ma'al akhiyar, ashrar ma'al ashrar. The righteous with the righteous, or the good with the good, and the evil with the evil. Another tafsir, وَإِذَا النُّفُوسُ زُوِّجَتْ is also acceptable. That since this is now ba'ath, it means the pairing of the bodies with the soul. I'adatul arwah il ajzadiha. That the souls now will be returned to the what? Body, because we become resurrected. Another tafsir, وَإِذَا النُّفُوسُ زُوِّجَتْ That the souls will be paired for the brothers, mashallah ta'ala, bushra lakum. Is zawj in Arabic will mean what? Ya Qaysar. Here we are. Barakallahu fiqh. I know you know that one. Wife. That's one of the first words I heard when I first started practicing. You know, the brothers in England, mashallah ta'ala, everything becomes Arabized. You know, how you doing? Kayfa halukunin. You get that? How you doing? Kayfa halukunin. You know? He said, okay, fahaluk. So be like, ahi man, I have to go and get my axe. I have to go and get my zawja, you know? Not ahi, axe. The axe. Instead of ikhwa, instead of ahi, the plural of ahi is what? Axe. Yes? Axe. Subhanallah. So, we used to face some tortures. I have a cousin, his name is Abdul Hakim. And I remember in Jahiliyyah, we never used to call him like that, Abdul Hakim. You know my cousin, Abdul Hakim. So, people used to make fun of his name. You know Aki and saltfish? You know Aki? It's a type of food, Caribbean food. We used to call him Aki and saltfish, you know? So when he first started practicing, we call him Hakim. He used to get, don't call me that, don't call me Hakim. So Zawja in Arabic means, it could mean a wife or a spouse. For either, wa either nufuz or zawijat means when the souls will be paired. Meaning when the men, bi idhnillahi ta'ala, they'll be paired with the hurul ayn. With the women of Jannah. The hurul ayn. MashaAllah, tabarakallah. Now the sisters may feel a bit, hurul ayn. The brothers will be paired with the hurul ayn. But what is better, or what is better? The hurul ayn or the women of this dunya, the believing women of this dunya. Luqman is thinking about it. I hope your family is not here. You should even think about it. Ala tuli. You should say the women of this dunya, the believing women, for the married brothers. And this is part of showing appreciation وَمَوَدَّ وَرَحْمَةً Love and mercy that Allah Ta'ala mentions in marriage. وَمِنْ آيَتِهِ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّ وَرَحْمَةً That he showed love and mercy to your wife and be romantic. Don't even think about it. Say, of course, the believing women of this dunya. That in itself is romance. Like the Salaf would do. They'll take their wives out and say, أَرَأَيْتِ الْقَمَرِ Can you see the moon? And the wife thinks, is this guy, is he cracked? What does it mean that I see the moon? Full moon. She said, of course I see the moon. He said, أَنْتِ أَجْمَلْ مِلَ الْقَمَرِ You're more beautiful than the moon. So you shouldn't think about it. Some of the Salaf, they'll say to their wife in the afternoon or the evening, كَيْفَ أَصْبَحْتِ How is your morning? And she'll be what? كَيْفَ أَمْسَيْتِ How is your evening? And the wife will be shocked. What do you mean about my morning and the evening? And you'll say to her, إِشْرَاقُ وَجْهُكِ غَرَّنِي حَتَى تَبَيَّنْتُ مَسَاءً صَبَاحًا So radiant is your face that actually mistook the evening for morning. SubhanAllah. As we should be. So the women of Jannah, because my family there too, the women, the women on a serious note, of Jannah, they better the women of the dunya of the Uhur al-Ain, because they had takalif, responsibilities upon their shoulders. And that's why they say in a hadith about Jannah, there'll be a river, and the Uhur al-Ain will be on the side, and the Uhur al-Ain will be on one side, the believing women of Jannah will be on another side. And the Uhur al-Ain will start to sing and boast, where are the wives? Of the righteous men, the believing men, the men of Jannah. No hands touched us. Lu'lu'um maknoon, where these sealed pearls, and they will boast and boast and boast. And the women, believing women, this dunya replied to them that we prayed, you never prayed. We fasted, you never fasted. And the men should order these. So the believing women this dunya, better. Wa idha nufusu zuwijat. And we end with this ayah. Wa idha al-maw'udatu su'ilat. And when the girl was buried alive, as we mentioned previously, from the Aada or the ways or the habits of some of the Arab tribes, not the Arabs, all Arabs, few Arab tribes, is that when a woman wants to conceive, they'll dig a hole. If it's a boy, they leave her. If it's a girl, وَإِذَا بُشْرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِمَا ضَرَبِ لِلرَّحْمَنِ One of them is giving glad tidings of what he gives, what he attributes to Allah, because they attribute to Allah girls. ظَلَّ وَجُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَرِيمٌ His face becomes black and he becomes angry and he is vexed. And yatawara is he feels humiliated min al-qawm, he's hiding from the people. Min su'i ma bushira bih, from the evil news which he's been given, he's embarrassed. Like now I have a daughter, and alhamdulillah, Allah's blessing with a daughter. But with them, yatawara is in humiliation min al-qawm. And that humiliation that he's thinking, al yadussu ala hawm. Should I keep this girl in humiliation? Oh, yadussuhu fit turab, or bury her in the sand. That they'll take this girl and just bury her in the sand. Immediately, some of them. Even if they were from the most noble. So subhanAllah, look at this ayat. The same way it makes the hair stand on your body, imagine those mushrikeen. That the first thing they're going to be asked about is what? Wa idhal maw'udatu. That when the girl that's buried alive is asked. And even the most noble of them practice this. From those nobles, Qais, Ibn al-Asim al-Manqari. Qais ibn al-Asim al-Manqari, he buried with his own hand 10 of his daughters alive. 10 of them. But this, like I mentioned again, was a few tribes. From those tribes that never practiced this, that actually stopped it, was the tribe At-Tamim, the Tamimi tribe. And Al-Farazdaq was from the tribe of what? At-Tamim. And this was in Jahiliyyah. His father, his name was Sa'sa' ibn Najiyah, At-Tamimi, he stopped it. And that's why Farazdaq, when he mentioned his grandfather, he praises him in a poetry. He said, وَجَدُّ الَّذِي مَنَعَ الْوَائِدَاتِ وَأَحْيَ الْوَائِدَ فَلَمْ يُؤَدْ That my grandfather is the one that stopped what? The burning of girl children alive. وَأَحْيَ الْوَائِدَ And he gave life to those who were buried alive, so they would not be buried alive. How do you give life to them? Sa'sa' Ibn Najiyah, every time someone wanted to bury their girl alive, he said, why are you doing this? They say, poverty. He used to give them, in exchange for them not to bury her alive, 2 camels. Sa'sa Ibn Najiyah At-Tamimi, through this practice, he saved 400 girls. 400. 400 times 2? 800 camels. You know? And this practice was not only with the Arabs, even some parts of the world, the West, China, and even of recent, contemporary, people still practice, this practice of bearing children alive hiddenly through abortion. Some people go for tests. The, what do you call it again? This thing, this scan, ultrasound, to find out if it's a boy, it's a girl. And if it's a girl, some people abort it, at all. You know, they abort it. They just abort it completely. So in some parts of the world, this is still practiced, that people still abort the children. And it's also partial abortion or partial burying. And the partial burying is, okay, the girl comes out, but you bury her humanity. So even the words that talk about human rights and blah, 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 they bury the humanity of a woman. She's seen as an object of pleasure, an object of excitement, a sila, a good, a commodity. In fact, she's not even a good or commodity. They use her to sell goods and commodity. Well, Islam, we don't bury, even after she's born, her humanity. In some places, likewise, due to a misunderstanding, some people, they bury the humanity of a woman by not allowing a girl to be educated. She should be educated, Islamically and even secularly, so long as the environment is conducive. So long as it's conducive. For وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ. And when this girl that's buried alive is asked, بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. For what sin was she killed? And this is a humiliation for the one that buried her. Because who's in charge of her? The father. But he's not even going to be asked, سُئِلَتْ. And this is a proof that these children that are buried alive as babies, they will speak يوم القيامة. بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. And this ayah, the way it moves you, it moves everybody, subhanAllah. That the first time I remember hearing this ayah was in college about 25 years ago. And it was in Ramadan. And some of us were not even practicing, was in the car. And there's a brother who was practicing to put the tape in. Nowadays you have CD, USB, those days it was cassette. You put the cassette in and it was translating into English ayah. The brother was in the car with us and everyone said, please stop the tape, please stop. That's how scared we became, that stop, 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 when it came to the ayah. So she'll be asked, and based on this ayah, how moving it is, some of the ulama, they have the opinion that these girls that were buried alive, يوم القيامة, because they have no sin, they'll be going to where? Jannah. That children, babies, even the babies of the mushrikeen, because if your children are mushrikeen, they're going to Jannah. We know the children of Muslims go to Jannah, inshallah. But the children of mushrikeen, they say Jannah. Although some other scholars say no, they'll be tested يوم القيامة, and according to whether they fail or pass, they go to Jannah. But some of the ulama, based on this, say no. Because these poor girls, what was their sin? بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. What was she killed for? وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَىٰ أَعْلَمْ. And inshallah ta'ala, next week we'll move on to the saying of Allah Azza wa Jalla, وَإِذَا الصُّحُفُ نُشِرَتْ. I apologize for the long lesson. Inshallah next week, or maybe not next week, because we now have a schedule. So I don't know if we complete this next week, if we'll actually get through our schedule finishing this whole thing by Ramadan. So I'll think about that. Either we try and finish by Ramadan, or we break somewhere. So at least we complete it properly rather than doing, chip-chop kind of thing. Barakallahu feek, subhanakallahu bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka.